conversation, because I think at the end of the conversation, it's certainly in my mind, it's left me with a massive amount more things that you would now want to explore, delve into, consider than certainly what I had in my mind when we started the conversation. Ilke, you started with the concept of real-time analysis by AI, and that analysis could be done thematically, through summaries, through filtering, through identifying concerns, and so on. We talked then about the possibility of AI being able to support the engagement of significantly bigger numbers, you know, 50, 80, 100, 150 people, where it can keep track of considerably more data than the normal human participant or facilitator. I suppose what that leads to, and Jim, I think you picked this one up, was the idea that maybe our whole concept of what it means to meet needs to shift. Mm-hmm. But that would have to be qualified by a point that Karen and Ilke made, which is that while we may not like meetings as humans, we absolutely not only like to meet, I think, but we need to meet. That's part of the human condition. Mm-hmm. Jim, you raised the point that if we don't meet, how do we have community? How do we have organizations? How do we have groups? How do we have teams? So the picture emerging from our conversation is that AI has this possibility to act as a fly on the wall. I think I introduced the phrase fly on the wall. It has that possibility not to take over the meeting, but actually to add to the meeting something that we humans actually can't add to the meeting. We can't step back from the totality of the conversation that's taking place. Mm-hmm. We can't analyze that totality in real time. AI can do that, and then it can feed back into the conversation. And Ilke, your point just towards the end of our discussion was maybe it can feed back in with a judicious question, with a thought-provoking question, with a summarizing question that can help to bring focus back, not to where AI decides the focus should be, but where AI has analyzed our content and said, here's the breakdown, here's the weighting, here's the emotion. And when we put it together algorithmically, here's the conclusion that you guys are reaching, not that AI is reaching. But that then brings us to, I suppose, I raised the point about security and the concept of if we're all being recorded, if that recording is being retained, and the purpose or role to which that recording is put in the short future or even in the long future, do we end up needing to protect and preserve that through some form of legislative framework? Jim, you raised the point that, well, perhaps organization norms, culture, standing operating procedures, guidelines, perhaps they can help us here. But it also begs the question that if people use AI output nefariously, then does it expose people to the point where they stop contributing themselves or of themselves out of concern that they may be misrepresented at a later date because that recording is there? And Ilke, you made the point that transcripts of the recordings are even more risky because they're now searchable. And so there's a big question there that we've touched on, but we haven't explored or we haven't bottomed it out. The overall conclusion that I'm drawing from our conversation so far is actually AI won't make meetings obsolete because we're humans, we're going to continue meeting. However, AI has a very strong possibility of completely transforming what we mean by meetings. Mm-hmm. And we all might just need to go back to the drawing board to say, well, what do we want meetings to be in light of the fact that we have this ear fly on the wall who can do so much more than we can't? And then we can ask ourselves, okay, how might we change our meetings in order to make maximum use of this all listening fly on the wall?